My dear people of God, André Fossard was from Belfast. He was an atheist and a prolific writer. He wrote many books to prove the non-existence of God. One day it so happened that he went for a stroll with his friend. And in Belfast it rains anytime. And it started heavy drizzle. And his friend had to leave him for a moment for some urgent work. And this fellow was left alone. And he found himself in front of a church and he needed shelter from the rain. So he entered the church. Remember, he's an atheist. Something told him, enter the church. He was standing outside. Enter the church. He entered. And what struck him was the glow round the tabernacle. He was struck by the glow round the tabernacle. And something happened to him. He left as if he was on glow himself. He was a changed man. He went back home and wrote the book, God Exists. He touched me. He has transformed me. God exists. This experience of André helps us to understand how a caterpillar also transforms into a winged, beautiful butterfly. So also all of us, our earthly bodies, will one day be transformed into glorious bodies. Let us reflect a little bit on the Gospel of Mark today. Jesus took with him three of his closest, as we say, inner circle disciples, Peter, James, and John. Why did he choose these three? Not only because they were his close friends. A little earlier to this, if we read the Gospels, Jesus was telling his disciples, now I have to go to Jerusalem, and there I will be put to death. I will suffer and be put to death. And Peter, in all his simplicity and love and honesty, he says, Lord, forbid that this should ever happen to you. Lord, forbid that this should ever happen to you. He loved Jesus too much. It's too simple. And Peter, who loved, and Jesus who loved Peter equally, had no hesitation to say, get behind me, Satan, he says. Get behind me, Satan. Because you are thinking the thoughts of men, not thoughts of God. Just imagine, Jesus could call his best friend, get behind me, he says, because you're thinking like a man, not thinking like God. Now, if your best friend, or if your parent, or if your principal, or anybody in your office shouted at you, what would you do? You would sulk. For 2 days, 3 days, you will be sulking. And you will be in bad mood, you will be remorse. And so you can imagine Peter, James, and John were sulking. Because Jesus called him, said, get behind me, Satan. He must have been sulking. So Jesus wanted to give them a shot in the arm, as it were. He called them up the high mountain, where he would get a glimpse of his glory before he would go to his passion, so that they would be able to sustain and embrace the passion. And he gave them the glimpse of his glory. And look what happened on the mountain. His clothes were, he became transfigured. He became clothes were dazzling white. Whiter than any bleacher could make on earth, the gospel says. And with him was Abraham, Elijah and Moses. Why these two people were with Jesus? The greatest of the prophets and the lawgiver. That is to tell us, that in Jesus, the law and the prophets is complete. In Jesus, both the law and the prophets is complete. Now, Jesus could have stayed up there on the mountain, the beautiful mountain. Anyone has been to Holy Land here? Put a hand up. How many have been to Holy Land? 2, 3, 4. You've been to Tabor, right? You've been to Tabor. Beautiful mountain there with cool breeze. And you feel something there. I've been there. You feel something there. God has descended on this mountain, and automatically, whether young or old, you'll go prostrate on your feet, on your on your knees, because God has descended on this mountain. Now Jesus could have stayed there, nice breeze there, why to go down? And Peter, and again in all his simplicity, says, Lord, it's so beautiful to be here. Let's build 3 tents, one for you, one for me, one for Moses and Elijah, and we stay up here only. Jesus says, no, nothing doing. Let's go down. Because Jesus knew what awaited him now in Calvary. He was on Mount Tabor. Now he knew what awaited him now in Mount Calvary. He had to go to fulfill the Father's will on Mount Calvary. However difficult, however painful, however excruciating, however horrible death it would be, he had to go. And he told them, don't tell anybody this, till the Son of Man is risen. And they didn't understand all that. And they were asking themselves, what does rising from the dead mean? Let's look at another point of today's gospel. All of us know that our faith is like a roller coaster. You've seen a roller coaster. Sometimes up, sometimes down, highs and lows, valleys and mountains. At this point of time, when the apostles were on the mountain, they were on the high. The faith was on the high. But soon they would reach a stage when it would flicker and almost die out. They too now accompany Jesus from Tabor to Gethsemane. And what would happen in Gethsemane? Jesus told them, stay with me. Stay with me a while. They couldn't. Their eyes were heavy, they're falling asleep. And when the soldiers came, they all ran away. Peter even denied Jesus. Their faith was at the lowest ebb at that moment. So you see, all of us have the highs and the lows. It seems that when we are high, we can almost reach out and touch Jesus. We're so high, we are so in euphoria, we can almost reach out and touch Jesus. And we can almost feel the Father putting his arms around us. We almost feel that. We can feel the Holy Spirit next to us, guiding us on our way in our life's journey. That's when we are on a high, when our faith is on a high. All of us have these high moments in our life. And then when we are in low moments, when our faith is flickering, ebbing away, we feel that everything is lost. What's happening to me? Jesus seems to have disappeared. He's gone on holiday. Nobody seems to be around me. No Holy Spirit, no God the Father. Nobody's around. Everything seems to be desolate. As somebody has said, when our faith is on a high, we are filled with love. And we want to hug everybody. We want to love everybody. We want to forgive everybody. And when we even say to ourselves, how can life be so dull? Everything is so beautiful. But when we are at a low ebb, when we feel we are alone, everyone has abandoned us, we feel oppressed, we feel desolate, our friends seem to have abandoned us, everybody seems to be our enemies, and we will talk ill about everybody else, and then we will say to ourselves, whoever said that life can be beautiful? Whoever said that life can be beautiful? And so we have these ups and downs in our life. Now if you paid attention to the first reading, you saw Abraham. Look at Abraham. An elderly man, old man. He was granted his wish to have a son at an old age of 75. And God calls Abraham, Abraham, Abraham. And he says, yes, Lord. And Abraham tells him, take your son and go to this place, which I'll show you. And there you will sacrifice your son. He must have been at his lowest ebb. He was at a high moment when he got a son at his old age. He must have been at high. And now God tells him, sacrifice your old son. Bang. Poor fellow. He must have been completely low at that moment. Sacrifice your own son. And Abraham knew very well that this son of his old age belongs more to God than to him. And he said, yes. He said, yes, I will do it. And he was about to sacrifice the son when the angel of God says, stop. God has seen you. And he will bless you and your descendants like the stars of the heaven and the sands of the sea. How beautiful. God sees us. So when we are at these low moments, remember, my dear brother, all of us will go to low moments. We have the high moments, we have the low moments, we are roller coasters. But when we had this low moment, think of Abraham. Think of his faith. He believed and trusted in God, and God blessed him abundantly, multiplied his blessings like the stars of the heaven. He was a tourist who visited the village, and he asked a farmer, he says, "Are any great men born here? Are any great men born here?" And the farmer said, "No, only babies are born here. Only babies are born here. We are not born great. We become great when we put on Christ. We become great when we put on Christ, when we are transformed and transfigured every day into Christ, putting on His values, putting on His garments, as we say, then we become great. We live Christ every day." St. Paul says, put on Christ. That is what we are called to do, to be transformed every day into Christ, and we put on Christ and we live Christ every day wherever we are. So wherever we are, people will say, "Wow, look at this guy, he's transformed. Look at him, he's radiant. Look at his smile, chaka-chak smile. Look at him, that is radiance. He's radiating Christ to others." That is what we have to be. Even if you're wearing a mask, I'll tell you something, if you smile, it can be seen in your jawbones, because you will still smile because you're radiating Christ. This is what we are called to do today, my dear brothers and sisters, to radiate Christ who has transfigured us, and then we will in turn transfigure others. Amen.